teaching, restoring and building.
Good afternoon and good evening. We bless the Lord and thank God for another Sunday as we come together and we worship the Lord, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We bless you for tuning in, and it has truly been a pleasure to come before you, and knowing that we're getting ready to come back in and we're going to be continuing to stream, but we're going to come back into the sanctuary. So I'm going to tell you to mark your date, mark this date down, mark your calendar, September 5th. September 5th, we will be here at Zion Global Ministries at 10:30. That first weekend, we will not have our Sabbath service, but we will begin on September 5th having services in person again. So we bless God that you will be able to come into the house here and worship together. And we will have everything set up for you just like it's supposed to be. And we're going to have a wonderful time on that day. Again, those of you who want to stay at home will continue to stream, so you'll be able to see the services from the comfort of your home. I will say to you right now, we need to start getting in practice of lifting our hands again. We need to get in practice of saying, praise the Lord again. I hope you have never stopped. It's not just because we're streaming that our relationship with God has changed at all. We lift up our hands even right now. We say, bless his holy name. We thank him right now for who he is and for what he has done for us all this time, during this pandemic, during this time of being away from one another. God is good, and he's been good all the time in spite of everything that we have faced. We thank God for that right now. Let's read scripture. Today I'm going to read to you from John 14. And starting with verse number one. The word says, don't be troubled. You trust God, now trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's home, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. If this were not so, I would tell you plainly. When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know where I am going, and how to get there. We thank God, for Jesus says he is the way, the truth, and the life. Let us pray. Father, I thank you right now for this day. We bless you, Lord, for all things work together for good, for them who love the Lord and are called according to your purpose. I bless you, Father, right now, because we are coming together around television sets and computers and tablets and laptops and cell phones. But Father, we're going to be coming together to worship you in person, one another, Lord. I bless you for that, Lord, that all of this time has passed by. But God, we know that you said you'll never leave us, you'll never forsake us for all the days of our life. And Lord, we are still here. We bless you for that. Thank you for keeping every family member, Lord, for all that they've been through, for all the suffering, for all the turmoil, Lord, but you have still been there, and I bless you for that. You have kept us, Lord, in spite of ourselves. Lord, you said you'll be there with us, and I thank you because you care for us, and we are to cast our cares upon you, Lord, because you care so much for us. Thank you for your love and your protection, and thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Lord, I bless you that someone today is going to hear something that's going to change their life, and somebody's going to say yes to Jesus Christ. And I pray they'll call the phone number that's on the bottom of this screen, Lord, and just give their lives to the Lord. I bless you for that. We are going to speak that into existence even now, that healing is going to take place, deliverance is going to take place, salvation is going to take place on this very day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now let's tune in and be blessed.
Woke up this morning, they let me know you were gone. Looks like the plans we made put an end to you. Walked out this morning and I wrote down this song. Just can't remember where to send it to. Oh, I seen fire and I seen rain. Seen lonely days that I thought would never end. Seen lonely times where I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Won't you look down on me, Jesus? You gotta help me to stay. Gotta get me through another day. My body's aching and my time is at hand. I won't make it any other way. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. Seen sunny days that I thought would never rain. Seen lonely times where I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. I've been walking my mind to an easy time. Back turned towards the sun. God knows when the cold wind blows, it can turn your head around. Been spending time on the telephone line, talking about things to come. All dreams and time machine fell to pieces on the ground. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. Seen lonely days that I thought would never end. Seen lonely times where I could not find a friend. See you again. spending time on the telephone line, talking about things to come. All dreams and time machines fell to pieces on the ground. Oh, I've seen fire and I've seen rain. Seen lonely days when I thought could never end. Seen lonely times where I thought I'd never have a friend. Oh, but I always thought that I see you. This morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Everybody, I'm here with my dear sister, longtime friend. We go back to grade school, Bond Hill Elementary School, mm-hmm. all the way through high school and college, we're hanging out. Mm-hmm. And you are the mother of this beautiful, beautiful child, Nailah.
Yes.
Brenda McGee.
Yes.
Wow, you laid a lot on me. Tell me about the pregnancy.
I already had two kids, but I was diagnosed with systemic lupus erythematosus. That's how you say it. So people with lupus can't really, it's really hard on their body when they have children. So that was one thing. So I was already a high risk because of that. And at that time, I was out of remission. So I was having a lot of trouble with it. So I was still in that battle, and then I ended up being pregnant with Nailah. And I was already at age of 39 years old. So it was really a struggle.
And so from there, you're watching her grow and develop.
Right, she was premature.
Yeah.
You know, so she didn't have color in her eyes, the things that normal, but she was 6 pounds, 4.5 ounces at 21 inches long. So she's in the NICU unit, all these babies were this big, she was huge. So she looked like a normal baby in the NICU unit.
Yeah. Wow. So she's growing up, and as you discover this word disability that
right.
everybody uses, you encourage her not to use it. And what
right.
What do you tell her that you can share with our viewers today?
You know, I named her Nailah because mm-hmm. Nailah means one who succeeds. So I reminded her constantly of her name. I said, you can't get here against all odds. When they said, you weren't gonna live a year. You know, you're here. So you have to trust God. And I said, that word disability, I never liked it. When any time they ever used it, I said, kick the dis out of disability, what do you have left in that word? So I made her study that. And she said, well, no. And so I said, ability. Embrace the word ability. Ignore dis. And we created a logo, and it does just that. It says disability, and it's a finger that kicks out the dis, and the dis is like that. And what you got left is ability.
Well said, and thank you so much, sis, for not giving up on this beautiful
yeah.
child. Look what we would have missed out on
right.
had you listened to those who said, don't do it. She's born to win.
Yes.
Thank you, girl.
Yeah.
All right. I don't even have words to describe the person that's before me today. She is near and dear to my heart. I would say, my daughter, my spiritual daughter in the ministry. And when I started this series, Born to Win, early on, she shot me a text saying that she enjoyed it. And being a young adult now, I was just shocked to hear from her. I'm just gonna be honest. And then I read further where she talked about how it impacted her. And she explained that she had a learning disability. I was in my man cave at the time. I sat back and I had tears in my eyes because in all of my encounters with her, I never saw this. And how brave it was, I thought, that she would share this with me. And I asked her if she would have the courage to share it with everyone, and she said yes. So here we are now.
Hello.
Yes, my dear daughter, Nailah Edwards.
Hey, Pastor.
Yes.
Thanks for having me today.
Yes, you have accomplished so much. In 2015, you were chosen to be Miss Black Teen Cincinnati.
Mm-hmm.
In 2019, you went back and you competed to be Miss Black Cincinnati, mm-hmm. and you were the first runner-up. Mm-hmm. Just graduated from the University of Cincinnati mm-hmm. in May. Mm-hmm. You're doing it, girl.
Yep, now you're trying.
That is awesome. And then you tell me about this disability. Talk about that.
Yeah, so growing up, or not even growing up, when I was in my mom's stomach when she was pregnant with me, I had a fetal brain tumor in the front of my head that almost cost me my life and my mom's life. But, you know, to speed things up, thank God that it went away. And I didn't die, my mom didn't die. I just had some struggles with a learning disability.
Let's pull back a little bit. The doctors did not expect you to live beyond what?
A year. And if I did live past a year, I would have been a vegetable, as they termed it. So thank God that I was not that. And I lived past a year, and here I am. So I do have some struggles.
You are a miracle.
I am.
And your mom named you Nailah mm-hmm. on purpose.
Yeah.
What's your name mean?
One who succeeds. And succeeding I am.
Yes, you are. Mm-hmm. So both of you could have died.
Yeah.
She had some sicknesses that she was dealing with at the time she was delivering you. Mm-hmm. It was a lot going on. Mm-hmm. But God had his hand on you.
Yes, he did.
During that entire time. And here you are.
Mm-hmm.
Now, tell me about your struggles and the social impacts that it's had, like in the classroom or with mm-hmm. friends and that kind of thing.
Yeah, so going back to, I would probably say grade school, I had really bad grades. a lot of the teachers didn't really show me any attention. I was just quiet because I really didn't know how to express myself. I was really ashamed of my disability. And then going into high school, I was a dance major, so that required me to, you know, use a lot of my movement, which I struggle with, especially on my left side. So with my reading and language-based disability, I had trouble understanding some of the French words that come with ballet. So a lot of the times, well, most of the time, I had to watch the other dancers to be able to understand what I was doing, because I did not understand, like, plié, grand plié. I didn't know what that was, so I had to watch to even be able to do it. And my teachers really got frustrated with me because they just thought I was doing that on purpose, but I really was struggling with it, and I didn't really know how to express that I was. So then, you know, I had my mom is my big advocate, who came in and was able to help them understand that. And they, you know, excluded me from all the shows because they thought I would never be like a prima ballerina because I just was not able to get it. And dance was like therapy to me because I was just able to, you know, let free and use it as movement to let go. So being able to do that was just, you know, very.
How did that impact your self-esteem?
In high school, I already had very low self-esteem. So with my dance teachers always doing that, and then my dance teacher actually said one day that really hurt me and really caused me to like really stop dancing was, he said, Nailah, you know, I really like you as a person, but I just don't like you as a dancer. I just don't really think you're gonna be a dancer. And he said it cold blood to my face. I really didn't know what to say but cry and go tell my mom because I was very disappointed. And, you know, he said it in front of people, so I really didn't know how to, you know, comprehend that, really.
And that still impacts you.
Yeah, because who says that to someone?
Let me show you something and tell you that you're in good company. Imagine me in a ballet dance class.
But, yeah.
And hearing those French terms, plié, grand plié, and all of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I just wasn't doing it.
Okay. But it's different for someone who has a passion
for it.
Right. And you say it to them, and they eat, sleep, and drink, dance, and then you just crush their dreams like that. And then in the back of my mind, I'm like, I actually struggle with it. I just really don't know how to tell you I struggle with it. And I'm really afraid and ashamed to. So it was different. Whether than what you said, yeah, I'm not doing that. I don't know what you're talking about, but I'm just not doing it. It was different for me.
It was different for you.
Yeah.
In time, God enabled you to get through it and dust that off of your shoulders. Because now you are some kind of extraordinary dancer. The spirit just moves through you. So with all of this, tell us, what were your coping strategies? How did you deal with all of this?
That's a great question. I'm trying to figure that out myself. But definitely the advocacy from my mom, constantly telling me what my worth was, to always know what my worth was, and to always strive for success, as what my name means. So, like I said, I stopped dancing, so I left that route. I graduated, cool, and then I went into my college life. So a lot of my IEP teachers were telling me, like, Nailah, and this goes into my education. There was like, I really just don't think Nailah's gonna be able to go to college. If she does, she's not gonna make it past her first semester. That's just not her route. So I had that on top of me as well, debating on if college was even for me before I even started college. So I had many different options. I wanted to go to like Kent State and Fordham, because I was interested in fashion at Kent State and dance at Fordham. Obviously, those two options were a lot of money, so I routed at UC. I really didn't want to go to UC. That was just like the option that I was left with, because I went to UC Blue Ash, and that's where I started, because I felt like that would have been the perfect option for me, because it's like smaller class sizes, more hands-on. It would have been perfect for me as a student with a disability. So I went there and I actually studied communication. So we'll get into how I went into communication, because I get a lot of people that ask me, like, Nailah.
Yeah, how did you choose communication?
Yeah, I get a lot of people that ask, like, Nailah, why'd you go into communication and journalism? That's something you struggle with. Isn't that hard for you? And I'm like, yeah, but I do it to embrace my abilities, because I know I struggle with it, so why not work on it every day to be good at it? So when I was Miss Black Teen Cincinnati, I was a public figure in the city, and I really say that pageant brought me out of my shell, including my mom. Like, she encouraged me to do that pageant, because before that I was like, you ain't about to get me up on no stage doing nothing in front of nobody, because I just don't have the courage to do that. But I did, and that was the best experience of my life, and I'm really thankful for Mr. Humphreys and that organization. Because
shout out to Mr. Humphrey.
Yes,
brother, we love you.
Yes, that was the pivotal moment in my life, because I had all those women around me encouraging me. I had Mr. Humphreys as dad number two, as he says, who was there as that guidance, and just being able to, you know, walk and talk with grace, and being able to do that, something that I was never able to do before.
So as a child, you struggled in communications?
I did. You couldn't get a peep out of me.
No. Is that right?
Absolutely not. I would sit there and not talk. I was actually bullied at one point in time, so I went through a lot. So I was in my little shell and didn't want to come out. But like I said, that was the pivotal moment for me, because I felt like people could see my worth. So I won the pageant, and I was all around the city, did a lot of community service, public speaking. I ran into Mr. Curtis Fuller, shout out to him too, my main mentor.
My main man.
He actually encouraged me to go into communication because I did a speech at the Black Family Reunion breakfast on like Black History, I believe. And that was the first speech I had ever given in front of all type of public figures in the city. It was a lot of people. And I did really well. And he came up to me and said, "You're about to graduate. What are you interested in doing in college?" And I was really indecisive, so I was like, "I'm not really sure." So he's like, "I think you should go into communication or journalism. Check that out." And I already knew he was on the news, so I was like, "This news anchor, big time news anchor, talking to me, telling me that I'm doing good. Listen here, I will take you up on that." So I went into communication, and I'm really glad that I do, because I really enjoy what I do in my field. Because I tell a lot of people I like to learn other people's stories. As I'm sharing my story right now, I like to hear about other people's stories and share their stories, because that's what's important. A lot of people really don't have that resource or that outlet, or don't feel like they want to or should tell their story. So I really, you know, enjoy this field.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So you will begin soon, mm-hmm, doing what?
I'll be working at a news station, a local news station.
Wow.
In Cincinnati, doing what I love. And coming out of college, I was like, "Listen, I'm out of college now. What am I supposed to do now? Find a job?" So I was like, "I don't know what I'm about to do. I don't know if I want to move. I don't know if I want to, you know, try a different career route." But ultimately, I stayed here locally.
And you're moving into your passion.
Moving into my
passion. Channel 5.
Yeah, and growing up, I was always there. So I consider it a full circle moment, because when I was Miss Black Teen Cincinnati, I did a lot of interviews there. So I was always in the newsroom. So I'm considering it like a full circle moment, like I'm going back to where I started.
One of my favorite passages in the Bible is Romans 8:37, where Paul says, "We are more than conquerors." Mm-hmm. I thought about that. How can we be more than conquerors? Mm-hmm. Well, here's what he's saying, is that when God's supernatural power gets into us, he enables us to do the supernatural, mm-hmm, things that people would say cannot be done. And that's what he's done in you.
Yes, he has.
Yes. You are a miracle, one that God has supernaturally moved through. Mm-hmm. You know, I was thinking about this on the way over here. Remember, every Sunday after service, you'd meet me over in the guest room. We hang out with your mom, and we have such a good time. And we have this special greeting.
Oh, yes, yes.
Let's show everybody what we do.
Shoot off. Let's go.
Boom.
Boom. We haven't done that in a while.
Yes. That means everything to me now.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we do that, it's saying that you are more than a conqueror.
Mm-hmm.
And sure enough, girl, you're born to win.
Yes, I am.
I love you. Thank you. Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you for sharing this. And for other young people who are struggling, what would you say to them?
Just keep striving. Don't ever let anyone tell you that you can't do anything, because you're more than capable to do anything, just as the person next to you who might not be categorized as someone with a disability, because you're born to win.
Love you. Thank you.
Love you too.
Okay.
You're welcome.